I'm René Stevens. This is the E of Real Estate. And today my guest is Per Anker Jensen. Welcome, Per.
Thank you.
Per Anker Jensen is professor in facilities management at the Technical University of Denmark and head of the externally funded Center for Facilities Management, named the Real Dania Research. He holds the degrees of Master in Science and Civil Engineering from 1978, and he also has done his PhD in 1985, and even an MBA, Master of Business Administration in 2004, of the Copenhagen Business School. And besides research and teaching, he has a 20 years period of experience from practice as a consultant, project manager, and also as a facilities manager. He was member of the board of EuroFM and also chairman of EuroFM's research network group in 2007 and 2008. And currently he is project manager on a joint EuroFM research project on the added value of facilities management, which started in January 2009. And besides all of this, he is an author of many books and scientific publications. So thank you for being willing to give this interview to our audience, especially as a real expert, as an academic expert, but also as a practical expert in the field of facilities management. And for those who are still arguing was the chicken first or the egg first, real estate or facilities management, actually this is one thing, and this is one integrated system, as we will discover during this interview. And in this podcast, I would like to focus more on not only the added value that we can bring with facilities management and real estate, but also how to measure that. And I want to explore your perspective about that with all those years of experience, but also the many PhDs that you guided over the years. So when we are talking about value added management model that you developed, you wrote a book, this one, Facilities Management and Corporate Real Estate Management as Value Drivers, How to Manage and Measure Adding Value. And my question is, added value for whom?
Well, it's for, in my perspective, multiple stakeholders. It's obviously for the organization, which is responsible for the core business, which facility management supports. But it's also added value for the staff, the employees, their quality of life, and it can also be for visitors or customers. And beside that, I also think that facility management can have an important contribution to the wider society, both sort of the local environment in relation to how the space you occupy sort of creates part of the landscape or townscape, but also in relation to creating jobs and in relation to sort of the economical development and social development and not least the environment and impact on climate and so on.
And that's a whole bunch of added value for many, many stakeholders, but they are not combined in one management board most of the time. Sometimes they are mainly focused on shareholder value. And how are you handled that?
Well, of course, the owners, the shareholders, they also is one important stakeholder, but from my point of view, there has clearly been a trend in general in society and in management thinking that Companies should not only serve their shareholders. Companies need to take on corporate social responsibility. So they need to show their value to society. And I think that facility management has an important contribution to that as well.
Mm-hmm. And when you zoom in for I would like to have that as focus this interview in university environments. So in learning environments. There is already more social impact, added value involved than in a multi-corporate organization, multinational corporate organization, where there's mainly shareholders and assets and money. But here there's also something about the future of a nation because of all those people who will get educated and get important positions in society afterwards. So how would you apply it in a setting as this? We are now at the Technical University in Copenhagen. You are a teacher yourself here, a professor yourself here. So a user, but you're also a professional. Hmm. How would you apply it here? Or how is it applied here?
Well, of course, a university is an organization where facility management is just not just an internal support function for the core business as staff. It's also a creator of the environment for the students and for all those who universities collaborate with, the companies here at DTU campus, main campus. We, for instance, has an incubator which is run by a subsidiary company to DTU, which has buildings here at campus and where startup companies and small companies who can gain from being close to a university environment, collaborating with researchers, employing students and attracting new staff from students who finish their studies. So it's a very complex organization. It's also very big facilities. Campus is quite complex facility with, for instance, many at the technical universities, as many labs and workshops and other sort of special facilities. One of the most recent is called Skylab, which is sort of a place where students can work with ideas to develop their own products and start perhaps companies and so on, with lots of different possibilities to work with both physical and digital equipment. But of course, creating the learning environment is essential and a special thing, because that's a main part of DTU's core business. So creating an attractive learning environment which students will choose to go to study is of course essential for DTU to fulfill its mission. Mm-hmm. And facility management has a very important role to play in creating this learning environment. And we see in these years also a big change in how universities work. We have much more digital learning aspects in teaching. Creating both the virtual environment and the physical environment and the social environment are three important aspects and should be also working together, create synergy. Mm-hmm. We have a lot of renovation and also new building going on at campus, so there's a lot of activities going on to improve the university facilities and the learning environments. Our library, as it was usually called, now it's called Knowledge Center, was renovated recently, and all the books there and paper journals and so on there, they are down in the basement. All the floors above ground, they are used for learning activities, different settings where students can work together or work in isolation, and where there can be events and so on. And also part of this renovation of the library, it has become a living lab for Internet of Things and Big Data, also in collaboration with DTU's campus service, so the library can have access to all data from DTU's building management system from all the buildings, and students and researchers can get access to these data and use them in their student projects and research projects. We of course have a lot of auditoriums, traditional auditoriums, but they are also in the process of being modernized, renovated. I myself do my teaching in one of these renovated auditoriums, where it has been changed with a layout where the students, they sit on different levels, but on each level there are I think 4 or 5 tables where the students can sit around and work in groups, and but at the same time they can also be involved in following lectures. So it's a sort of flexible space which accommodates the teaching which I do and prefer, a mix of different methods of teaching, lectures, group assignments, and also try to do a bit with sort of interaction, doing sort of digital online surveys. I have much use of my PhD students to also help developing the teaching to become more interesting.
Just to give a feeling for the number of students that are on this university, so the Danish Technical University, DTU.
Yeah, we have around 11,000 students. Most are on this main campus, but we also have an other campus here by Copenhagen, where some of the students go particularly for bachelor degrees, while the last part of the bachelor education and normal master education is done on this main campus.
And have you a number of how many square meters is this campus for the?
I haven't got numbers okay. Sort of present.
Okay, but about 11,000 students.
So yeah, and about. Yeah. Between 5,000 and 6,000 staff, including PhD students. As a technical university, we have a quite high ratio between staff and students.
Mm-hmm. And those improvements and refurbishment of the learning environment to the new educational concept of more mixed learning. Who is the one who is initiating this? Are that the faculties? Is that facility management says you should try this, or is it the board of directors?
Well, it's very much a combination. When renovation of auditoriums or other teaching environments are taking place, it's sort of the campus service, the facility management department who are sort of in the lead, but they work very much together with teachers and students, get inputs, the requirements and the ideas for how to improve it. And they also have done a lot to sort of collect international experiences from how modern learning environments could be laid out. Also, there's of course from the individual institutes, departments, and teachers, there are sort of initiatives. But we also have initiatives from the board of the university. For instance, it's now been part of the sort of strategy that all departments should have at least one of these. Open internet courses, so-called MOOCs, massive open online courses. We already have one here at my department. One of my colleagues, or some of my colleagues, have been developing a MOOC, and one of my colleagues is also, in fact, doing research on MOOCs. How collaboration between students can work in relation to MOOCs, which by principle is sort of very individualized. It's students from all around the world who follow them individually, but by creating sort of connections between students in working together in groups, it's possible to increase the learning experience, and it's also has a clear effect on how retention of students, because one of the problems with MOOCs is there's a lot of students fall off. They don't fulfill the classes or the courses, but by improving the teaching, working with co-learning, you can in fact keep students on the course to a much higher degree.
Do you mean by co-learning that there's a kind of social pressure, peer pressure from fellow students that are teamed up and they say, come on?
Yeah, well, it's helping each other, yes, but virtually. They don't meet except online.
Yeah, okay. And how is your ICT department of this university involved in this? Are they in the lead just as facility management is in the lead for this part of learning, so the digital learning?
Well, they are of course involved in supplying the software which are used, for instance, for MOOCs and other digital technologies. We have a separate IT department at centrally placed at DTU. We also have in each department a few supporters to help staff. They are most definitely involved in creating both the infrastructure and providing the software that's needed.
Yeah, I'm interested in this part. That is it that you make in a studio a course, a online course for students, and or is it you give a lecture for the normal students who are present here that is recorded and others can see that also?
Yes, our group, which I'm part of, on implementation and performance management, are responsible for DTU's largest course. It's called TEMO, standing for Technology, Organization, Management, and Economics. Oh, the other way around. That runs every semester, and this semester it has 550 students, which is more than we can have in one room at the university, except there is some sports halls which can be used, but they are not used for teaching except for exams. There we can't simply have the students together, so there We have all lectures recorded and streamed sort of online so that students can sit in another room or other rooms or at home and follow the teaching. And we also there have then for those who are in the room where the teaching takes place, we have sort of mobile microphones, which can be, it's a big cube with soft cube, which can be thrown to a student so they can ask their questions. So those students who are not present in the room, they can hear what's been asked and what's been answered to the questions.
That reminds me of what you shared with me about your experience in your working life, that you were involved in the radio broadcasting company here in Denmark. So it sounds to me like a talk show. So there's a presenter, there's a small audience just for the surroundings, but the main audience is somewhere else watching the show.
Yeah, that's right. Yes, it was both television and radio broadcaster, the national Danish broadcaster, and of course there are similarities between between a broadcaster and the university, particularly in the digital world.
So even students who are full-time studying here at this campus in Copenhagen, they can follow that online course. So they say, okay, I don't come to the campus today, I stay at home or whatever, in Starbucks, and I watch the online version. That's possible.
Yes, but still we combine the lectures very much with students working together in groups. So to do that, they need to be on campus, and we are very focused on making the learning environments at campus attractive and suitable for collaboration in student groups. So even though we have a distant learning, like MOOCs and these streamed lectures, we encourage the students to come to campus, because the learning outcome is increased considerably if students work together.
Yeah, physical contact between human beings is cannot be replaced by digital contact. Sophisticated Zoom or Skype or whatever it is. You need the physical contact. Yeah, I agree with that. And in attracting new students, so you said something about, okay, we do here research at the university, we do teaching about that research to students, we help them in doing research and in learning things, but also to find an application in daily life, daily society. So that was the startups and the incubators and all the things you mentioned. You said, okay, we also use it for the student experience and also the outcome. But it's also your marketing department who attracts new students. Are they also involved? That they say, okay, for attracting more students, you should do more this, little of that.
Well, I haven't really experienced that.
Okay,
they
yet.
May do, but it's not something I have sort of been involved with.
Okay, could be, but you are not aware of it.
Yeah.
And of course, the main users or the main target group of the university are the students, because without students, there is no university. But what about the staff, the employer, the employees, and the professors, the teachers? They also have an experience. Eh? Students come here 4 years, 5 years, maybe six, then they're gone. But when you're employed, probably it is much longer than that. How are they involved in? So it's also let me rephrase it, a focus on the work environment besides the learning environment and work for the employees.
Yes, there is, but I think it's fair to say that university staff are pretty conservative in relation to development of their work environment. They very much like to have their own office, also doing research needs concentration. You also need to have a possibility to have private meetings, both with students and PhD candidates and collaboration partners. So we are not in the front with sort of new ways of working as a university. But of course, there is also a development going on there, and the digital environment is also very, very important. A lot of researchers have a lot of contacts internationally, so being able to communicate via digital technologies is very important. I even got a student who's at Hawaii doing some student work there, but also doing a course where I supervise him by having Skype meetings when there's a need for that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, when there is something new, that does not mean per definition that the old is not good enough anymore. So. When the results are there, actually there's no need that everybody should work in an open space, a flexible open space. So when the work requires that there is a lot of concentration, why not? So I think that both possible. Okay, so there's a lot going on in new developments, anticipating in the changing society, rapidly changing society. So the way of learning and teaching is also changing. Do you measure it, the impact of all these improvements? And how do you measure it?
We first of all measure by evaluating students' response to the courses they fulfill. That's done on all courses, part of our university IT system. So that's what we do in relation to sort of the feedback to individual teachers. Beside that, we have as a university a survey of satisfaction survey among all the staff. I can't remember whether it's every second year or how frequent, and that's a survey which is used for all Danish universities. DTU can decide on a few specific questions to add, but most of the survey is a national standard. The HR department, it's probably the student administration. They also do general surveys among the students, and I think that the campus service do some surveys among specific environments, mm-hmm. new environments they have renovated.
And are you aware of some remarkable outcomes, or is it already long enough going on, this measurement and this changing of the learning environment, the working environment, that you can have a kind of benchmark that there's things are improving or there's some point of attention?
Yeah, well, that is obviously done when there are these surveys to compare how different groups, different departments are placed in relation to satisfaction, dissatisfaction. And when we have had such a survey, the staff satisfaction survey, we have in each group or each division, we have a process where we evaluate these results and make a sort of action plan for improvements. That's what done for the staff survey. Exactly how the different surveys among students are used, I'm not so much involved in, except of course from my own facility management course, I get the evaluation results and can use that in the development of my teaching.
Okay. So there's a feedback loop to the core business, so the educational concept you have. So for instance, does this mix learning in lecture hall and working in small groups in the same room, is that working? Is that adding value? But also, I assume that there's a feedback loop to the facility management department here.
Yeah.
That, okay, this is working or not as good as we want it to be.
Yeah.
Are you aware of things like that for the facility management department?
Yes, I'm aware that they do that because I collaborate with them. And even two of our former PhDs, they and I'm working for the campus service here, and one of my PhD has worked for campus service this spring or spring semester. I had a master thesis done in cooperation with campus service, and I have had that earlier as well, so we work quite a lot together with them. I'm just at the moment involved in a research proposal about developing a sort of big data facility management system where the DTU campus service is also involved as case organization. So we have quite a lot of collaboration.
And is that that big database to find the correlations between the whole picture and not just parts of it? Is that sponsored and by the top level management board?
No, it's a collaboration with my institute and the campus service and an external. It's an external sort of startup company who's developed this system and are now applying money from external sources to lead it to market, commercialize it.
Because I can imagine, just like some of my clients who are universities, that the management board is very much interested in their relative position in the ranking of those national surveys. So how does this university compare with another technical university, if there is something like that in Denmark? I don't know. How their score is.
Yeah, well, that's much more on international level, I'll say.
Okay, you of know, course. Yeah, yeah.
The rankings of universities international, and there's also rankings of technical universities, and the DTU has in the strategic goals defined where they would like to be positioned in relation to these rankings in the Nordic countries in Europe and among all technical universities.
Okay. And are you aware that there is a operational system, so there's a clear KPA, key performance indicator. We want to have this position in the ranking internationally. And we are aware that there's, of course, something to do with the way of teaching we do and the quality of the professors we have, but also about the environment in which we offer this learning.
Yes.
Is that clear enough? Formulate as KPI that your facility department here is now okay when we want to contribute to that main goal. So in the ranking internationally, then we have to do this, or we can do this and that in the campus environment.
Well, the development of the campus environment is one of the strategic objectives of the university, but I'm not aware how that is measured.
Okay. Clear. Yeah. And you were telling that there's a program going on in fitting out existing buildings to a new way of teaching, so integrated, making flexible use of auditoria. The teachers are involved because they have to do the work over there. How are the students involved? So, for instance, when a new project starts, is there a panel of students that follow the process and give input and feedback. Yes.
There will be sort of a joint user group with both teachers and students and administrative staff involved. There's a sort of a broad screening of all the needs and expectations, and also I think there's a process during when a project is conducted.
Okay, so not only in the schedule of requirements, but also in the phase of execution.
Yeah, I think it is.
And the. You hear and you read in lectures and literature that collaboration is a main thing in creating something between us humans. And what is your viewpoint that how can the built environment, and let's also take the digital environment, help in creating more collaboration between students and staff, among themselves and intertwined within students and staff?
Yeah, well, that's very much by creating a variety of different spaces. So there's some choices for where you can work. We have a lot of facilities with computers, data bars, where students can work on IT systems, but we also got a lot of sort of varied settings where students can work sort of where they decide to work, and others where they can work in the auditoriums or the classrooms. And as mentioned, the former library is very much now aimed at creating a working environment for students. And we also, for sort of our master students and our PhD have as far as possible possibility to offer them a workplace where they can work close to where their supervisors are, and also gain benefits from sort of being in an environment with other master students and or other PhDs, so they can support each other.
Yeah, so we discussed that society is changing in a rapid pace. So the learning system has to adapt to that because demands are different, problems are different, more challenging even. In the old days, we have faculties, so this department, that direction. But the problems nowadays are so complex that multidisciplinary approach is needed. So one of the solutions the university world says, okay, then we have not focus on the individual student, but they have to work in groups to create a solution together. But that is still within the same faculty. Is there a program to create a problem-solving learning between disciplines? So not only the faculty of architecture, for instance, but also the faculty of engineering or computer science or psychology. Or there's a Technical University, maybe that's not here, but...
Well, we have one faculty university, so there's... only engineering at this university, but of course we are divided in a large number of institutes and centers. There are much focus on creating collaboration between different groups, disciplines. Often that is done sort of in research projects where you work together with people from other institutes in particularly the larger research programs or projects, where we also typically have a collaboration with other universities and companies, not least the EU Horizon 2020 projects. There you need to be group of parties from different countries involved, typically or both from universities and from companies. So there you very much work with different disciplines, both from DTU and from other universities.
Mm. Yeah. Okay. So when the aim is to work more and more in groups and multidisciplinary approach, the main thing is of course that your curriculum is about that, because otherwise it will not happen. But when you have it in your curriculum and in your teachings, what can you do more with the built environment and with the digital environment to facilitate that more, or to encourage it more? Whether it's interdisciplinary, maybe normally you are in building A and the other part of the team is in building B and some in C. Where do you meet? Is there something in between, or is in every building a room where you can work in multidisciplinary teams from other parts of the faculty?
There's not special facilities for that, I don't think, but what we do have are some conference facilities, and DTU has arranged conferences also for joint conferences arranged by the whole DTU. For instance, we have a conference called DTU Sustain, which is about sustainability, and where people from all departments are invited to come and give presentations and present posters, etc. So that's one way of getting different groups closer together, learn about each other's work and learn each other, and therefore create background for more collaboration between different departments and disciplines.
Yeah, as we both know that many scientific breakthroughs are happened or in dreams state, or that there is a multidisciplinary approach, or that you approach it from a completely different field of expertise and then look at the same thing but with new eyes and a new perspective, and then solve a issue. And so I can imagine that when you facilitate that, that will increase the level of education. And probably the former library is such an example as an environment created for this.
And of course also we got a faculty club, one of the of several canteens, which mostly is open for students as well, but that's where mostly staff go to have lunch together, and if you've got guests then you go there and so on. So these kind of facilities are also facilitating sort of staff from different departments and discipline they meet.
As designers, we know that it is not only about buildings and what is happening inside buildings. Many things happen also between the buildings. Even a city is mostly about the space between buildings. So this is a very green campus, that part that I went through when I came to you. Are there some programs to use all these nice greeneries outside?
Yes, sort of development of places where particular students can be working outdoors, or can do some sport activities, and also one big development which happened here in at campus is that we are going to have a light rail going through campus in a few years, and as part of that there's also plans to to make a stronger sort of central plaza where people to a higher degree can meet.
Yeah, and so the central marketplace in a city or a town. That is not yet in place.
No, that is in the planning. Some preparatory work has started, but.
So when I would ask what is the main place here on this campus, probably somebody would say there where the board of directors in that building.
Yes, we have a central building where the administration is placed, and where there's also the faculty club and the main canteen and this. The former library, the knowledge center, bookstore, and there's a student house where there's a cafe and pub and spaces to play billiards and so on, and where there's also concerts and things like that, and conference facilities there's also, and a big sports hall with a big gym.
When you ask and allowed to dream, Pierre, and you were giving a substantial amount of money to create that dream. With all your experience as a professor, as an expert in the field of facilities management, and being very well aware what that the environment can add a lot of value to the prime process in that environment. What would you do? Where would you spend your money?
Well,
focus on this campus. What would you change more sooner? Or?
Well, if I should ask from my personal perspective,
yes.
Well, one of the things that I would really like to see is that we have a center established where we join. The different disciplines which are involved in research and teaching in the built environment. Today we are sort of scattered in different departments, and if we could create a joint center as campus, I think that would be a great thing.
So when I try to translate in my terms what you say, actually, you're saying I would like to have more interdisciplinary approach of the field of facilities management than what is happening now.
The built environment. Yeah,
built environment. It would be more enhanced when we would be in close proximity of each other in the same building or the same area. Okay.
So that would also be an organizational thing, of course.
That's a nice bridge, because we covered two parts of my definition of the work and learning environment, the physical part for real estate and facilities management, the digital part for the ICT, but there's also a social environment, and that's all about agreements, behavior, culture, leadership, or management style. Probably that is the most important part in the whole system.
I think also one of the things that would be good to do at DTU is to open up the university more to the surrounding world. That is happening. There's an organization around this local area, the municipality here, which is called the Knowledge City. So there's a collaboration between the university, the city, and lots of companies, and etc., about developing this Lyngby municipality into a knowledge city, and thereby also creating more collaboration and openness. One of the things which that's planned is to build student housing in near the center of the city of Lyngby, because it is a very strong sort of shopping center building or city, but there's very little life in the evenings and so on. And on the other side at the campus to have more opportunity to have activities which involve the people living around and the companies and so on. We are having also increasingly companies locating themselves close to DTU, so there is things happening in this direction, but DTU is still quite a lot of an island.
Yeah, so you suggest approach that don't change the system by changing the rules and the people, but to build a new one and then make it obsolete, the old one. So by bringing fresh blood in and open the gates, although there is no real gate and you can come in if you like, culture will change.
Yeah.
And also the you said professors or staff are very conservative.
Mm.
So when new blood comes in, things will change.
Also, as you have probably experienced coming here, the public transport is today not very optimal.
No.
So having the light rail will also really be a big improvement.
Yeah. But also bringing society in. But again, a critical question. It is more just open the gate and come have a picnic here in the park surrounding because it's very nice, or walk with your dog in here over the campus area. But how do you involve the society who is not studying here and who is not a company who you are doing mutual research with? Open the canteen for them or something like that, or
is in principle open for everybody, but there needs to be some activities which are attractive for people to come here. Possibility could, for instance, be to arrange evening classes for the public. In fact, we are just about to start having teaching in the evenings. We haven't had that earlier, and we also have recently started having teaching in July and August, which we haven't had earlier. So that, and that's because also that we have more and more students coming in, so we need to increase capacity. There could be much more sort of activities which would sort of make the border between the university and the surroundings less firm.
We now talked about your dream with a substantial amount of money to realize, so you just could do it. But probably there are also some things that you say, this is really hindering me in my teaching. So is there something like that that you say, when they change that tomorrow, that would really be an improvement?
Not so much in relation to my teaching. One things which I think is not so convenient here where I have my office is that we are placed with sort of a long corridor with offices only on one side, so we are sort of not very close together. It's much mutual contact between staff as there was where we were before we moved to this building, where we had was placed on the same corridor with sitting next door to each other opposite the corridor and so on.
Now you give a very practical suggestion for the facility department to rearrange some internal separation walls,
mm.
which will have a great impact on the core product, education and research.
Mm.
And of course, yeah, it costs something, but the impact will be great.
Yeah.
Okay, so I assume that you gave them already this suggestion and that they're working on it right now.
Well, I haven't really been in contact with the campus service about this, but it's something we have talked about in between colleagues, mm-hmm. at least.
You actually said already, but I just want to check. You said, in fact, the physical being together has a huge, higher impact on the studying study results than only online.
Mm.
Do you see a shift from that online study is increasing compared to physical contact, or is it the same, or is it?
Well, I think there's a double trend there. I think that online teaching is increasing, but the increase of group work among students, collaboration between students, most definitely has increased a lot as well. And as I mentioned earlier, also there's attempts to try to create more collaboration also on online courses, so that mm-hmm. students can benefit from mm-hmm. co-learning.
Yeah, I can imagine that the competition field for students is not only Denmark, it is internationally, like
Absolutely.
Also other universities. Why other wise be interested in the international ranking? So you are competing with other universities for international students,
and also for researchers staff.
Sure. Come back to that in a minute. I can imagine that having followed a online courses, living in Malaysia or Brazil or wherever. And I said, wow, this is really great. I apply also for a summer course here, physical, or a whole year. That could be also a trend, that's to attract more international students and to get higher rankings in the international surveys, that the online learning is just the first step.
Yeah, well, it's a way of creating more visibility for the university. And I think that is part of why it's been chosen that have more focus on these MOOCs.
Yeah, so a kind of, when I say it, maybe not so honorable, a marketing tool also.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. And I said I'm coming back to that question. I once heard from a facility manager from an American university, they said, we apply or we use the built environment to attract top talent as professors. And how are we doing that? Said normally it is more practical from a real estate standpoint. Okay, all the labs with all the different requirements on this side, that building, and offices in another building, and sometimes even not close to each other. And we say, okay, professor, when you come at our university, you get your offices next to your labs.
Yeah.
Another example, I told this story to a university in the Netherlands and said, we did similar things. Or the one of the members of the board did similar things. Mm. There was one Nobel Prize winner. He could choose where in the world he would like to work as a professor. And there was a lot of competition. Mm. And they brought him to the Netherlands. Why? Because that board member said to him, when you come to us, you get a complete building.
Mm.
That was anyway vacant. But you get the complete building. We have a budget for your labs and your offices, but you have to come to us. And by the way, for your wife, we also search for a job.
Oh.
And of course, he came. So it is even used in a completely different way to attract top talent.
Absolutely.
As teachers, which is affecting your core business.
We, in fact, are quite lucky, so to say, that when this campus was established in the 60s, early 70s, most of the buildings are sort of very standardized, three stories with a central corridor on each story. But the layout is differentiated, so one side of the building is sort of normal sort of office depth, while the other side there's more depth, so that can be more flexible, used for laboratories, for teaching rooms, etc. In that way they provides the opportunity that the staff are close to labs and to some of the seminar rooms or things like that, and can be sort of developed to suit these different needs or how they change over time. Mm-hmm. So it's possible for staff to be close to their research facilities.
A personal question: what is the daily routine you do, or is there something that what makes you successful in your work?
I don't think so much in the daily routines I have. I think one of the very important things as a researcher is to have a strong international network to other researchers. I collaborate quite a lot with a guy from Delft University, written or edited this book together, and yeah. We worked together on this Euro FM work group, yeah. On the added value.
Theo van der Voort.
Yeah. We have had a really close collaboration over many years, but also in this book, I think there's we are 23 authors or so on. So these are all part of our network, our joint network. So we can invite them to write chapters, and they also, many of them have been involved in workshops we had over the years. So I think that's essential both for me to develop professionally, but it's also what makes it fun. It's interesting to have these contacts.
One final question to wrap it all up. So the book is all about how to manage and measure adding value.
Yeah.
And so several topics we discussed, what could be added value. With your experience, when you said when a university or audience listen to this interview and say, where should we start? What should we do first? What has the most impact to start first, to have a quick win and to convince the other conservative part?
Well, first of all, you should look at the strategy of the corporation, so that you focus on the things which supports the corporate strategy. I think that's essential. That's why you should focus on doing things that adds value. In relation to how you measure, one of the essential things in measuring is that you should distinguish between measuring the output from facility management or corporate real estate management, the space you deliver, the services you provide. That is important, of course, to measure that, to be better at doing it. But what's really important is also to measure what is the impact on the organizational performance of the whole organization. So distinguishing between these two different measurements, output and outcome, you could say, is essential to be able to add value. Because one thing is that you measure the output and the outcome, but you should also then evaluate, do they really fulfill the organizational objectives? And you should also evaluate what are the sacrifices by doing interventions which create a benefits, because added value is a trade-off between benefits and sacrifices, where sacrifices typically are sort of related to cost and risk, while the benefits are those things which creates a positive impact on the core business organization.
I think that's a very, very valuable summary of this discussion and the takeaway for our audience. Why? Because I also noticed that many surveys facility management or real estate management departments are executing are more about satisfaction about their work for their customers. And they gave us this or that mark. But the main question is indeed, how does it benefit the big thing, the organization where you're working for, and not only are they satisfied with the performance of your department, the users. Mm. Thank you so much, Pierre, that for your time and for this interview, and also for the for the very pleasant exchange of expertise and knowledge we had before this interview. Great to meeting you.
Great, thank you.
You're welcome.